Good evening, and welcome to Doctorpiece Theater. My name is Dr. Dennis Business, and tonight we will continue our dive into This Is Why I Hate You. When we last left our hero, things had just gone crazy. Do any other animals drive cars? Chapter 21, Four Blue Falcons. A couple months have passed since my last entry. Things between Corey, Booty, and I have been pretty amazing. There are very few communication barriers between the three of us, and absolutely none between Corey and I. There are some things about myself I never told Booty, but she hasn't known me as long as Corey, so maybe in time. As for how romance even works among the three of us, our relationships are just how they were in the last entry. Corey is with Booty, or I guess it's time we start calling her Rachel, as that seems to be what Corey respectfully prefers I call our girlfriend, and I'm with Rachel too. There's no real physical romance between Corey and I, because that's just how being gay works for most people. The one thing that has evolved between the three of us is when one of us is making love to Rachel, the other person doesn't bother with leaving the room. Sometimes Corey will just smile and glance over from time to time when I'm with Rachel. I really love how it feels to be watched by Corey while I'm actively intimate with another person I care deeply for. I love the fact we just don't see the point in hiding who we are from each other. The freedom is overwhelming. Now, with that amazing aspect of my life aside, I get to talk about Airman Asher, a southern boy who we recently found out is close friends with Airman Austin, the one-eyed pervert. Corey and Rachel were in the hall of the dorms at one point holding hands. Corey was hesitant to show any public affection due to the fact she didn't want people to know she was gay, but she held hands with Rachel anyway. Corey has gone through tremendous hardships with her family never really being supportive of her homosexuality. Knowing her story makes it pretty evident that her behavior is partially a result of being judged and harassed for how she was born to be. The military being passively hostile towards homosexuals, combined with Corey's difficult past, were what caused Corey to deny Rachel's attempts to show public affection repeatedly before. Rachel has not gone through the things Corey has. Unlike Corey, Rachel is attracted to both genders, and in that when she tried to pretend she was purely straight, it was far easier. Rachel is also the type of person to not fully weigh the potential consequences of her actions, like Corey is, but Corey slipped this one time, and that's where Airman Asher comes in. Asher was walking down the hall, not too far behind them, when they held hands for the first time openly. They didn't see Asher because he was just coming around the corner behind them. Once Asher saw them holding hands, he reported it straight to Senior Airman Austin. Considering Airman Austin was already working in the squadron building, he could have easily passed the information along to the administration. Instead, Airman Austin chose the even more despicable route and tried to use the info Asher gave him as blackmail. I don't know how things are at the time you're reading this, but as of this date, the military maintains a don't ask, don't tell policy. That means Airman Austin's threat was very real and very harmful. The man already lost an eye screwing with people I care about, and still doesn't have the foresight to know when to back off. He has a death wish, and if he keeps this up, maybe he'll get it sooner than later. I spoke with Corey and Rachel about it in depth, and for the most part, we've all accepted the possibility of them being discharged for their sexuality. We aren't going to be puppets of Austin. He was asking us to basically do his desk job for him to keep quiet, and we refused. Since then, Asher paid us a visit. I was in the chow hall with Rachel and Corey when Asher approached our table. Forcefully pushing his way into the booth seat table next to me, he asked, "So y'all are just orgy all the time, or what?" The two girls remained silent, ignoring what he said. I hated seeing Corey and Rachel uncomfortable like this. I leaned over to Asher, and in a low tone, said, "Get out of this booth and walk away, Asher." With a disgusted look on his face, Asher kept walking towards the girls in his southern accent.
"Y'all are both disgusting freaks. Y'all are gonna burn in hell, you know that, right? Where I come from, we string your kind up with..."
I flipped Asher's tray of food in his face and kicked him onto the floor. One of the airmen who was watching everything go down jumped up and screamed at Asher,
"You idiot! He'll rip your eyes out!"
Asher was no doubt in a state of shock. At least he looked like he was, as the chocolate milk and mashed potato gravy ran down his freshly dry-cleaned BDUs. Little Asher, sitting on the floor, mortified like he was, the room couldn't help but burst into laughter. Rachel looked at me and said,
"We should go."
I could barely hear her over all the people laughing at Asher. I shook my head and waited for Rachel to continue eating as I worked on finishing the rest of my burger. Just a side note, you might think I'm horribly fat from eating all this meat. It's not true. I weigh 178 pounds and I'm just an inch shy of 6 feet tall. Bullshit. Some people, like my dad, will have you believe that if you eat meat, that means you'll be obese. That's not always true. Obviously, it's not the case for me, and opinions like that are especially ironic coming from a donut-obsessed, beer-bellied pile of lard like my father. Back to Asher. He got up and stormed out of the building, leaving his tray face down on the ground. I would have imagined ending Asher's miserable life if I didn't feel so damn sorry for him. He was so stupid. I'm surprised he could even get into the military. One of the local Korean employees tried to clean up the mess of the tray I left, but I insisted I take care of it. It was significantly my fault anyway. After about 40 minutes, we were all done eating, so we walked out of the chow hall as a group. Unfortunately, as we exited the building, Asher, Austin, and two of their friends were standing just across the street to greet us. It was getting dark. There were heavy clouds overhead, and the wind made it feel uncomfortably cold out. The four men just stood there, almost in some sort of thug formation, like they were posing for a rap album cover. Asher didn't even bother to clean up his uniform. He was trying so hard to look tough. The level of pity I felt for his sad little life knew no limits. I spoke in a soft but serious tone to Corey and Rachel. You guys go back to the dorms and I'll talk to these guys. Corey, being the loyal friend she's always been, replied, I'm not walking away from you like this, Arthur. But Rachel added, Artie is a combat expert, so if these guys are stupid enough to try anything, they're screwed. We're just a distraction to Artie if we stay. Corey leaned up to my ear and whispered, I love you, and squeezed my hand before they started walking a detour route to avoid the four men. As the girls left, I watched the four men closely. They didn't seem to care about following them. They were here just for me. Good. I said aloud to them, Well, here I am. They did nothing in response. They just continued to hold their rap cover pose. It was literally like each of them were doing their best Vanilla Ice impression. I didn't know whether I should laugh or facepalm. I wanted to get things over with, so I proceeded walking towards the four men. I had no weapons on me, but I likely wouldn't need any. I spoke as I walked towards them. Do we have something to talk about? Asher screamed back. No, we have a beating to talk about. Hearing Asher say that annoyed Airman Austin. He screamed at Asher, Shut up, you idiot! Now standing in front of them, I asked, What do you want? Austin maintained a serious expression as he spoke with hostility. You know, Linfelt, I came here hoping I could kill some chongers, and now the only person I want to hurt is you. I replied, So hurt me, Asher. A patrol car pulled up behind us. Without delay, a security forces sergeant stepped out and shined a light on us. Are you kidding me right now? He asked us in an angry voice. I greeted him. Hello, sergeant. The sergeant was not amused. Don't talk, Linfeld! I stood silently, saying nothing in response. The sergeant turned to the four men and said, Disperse! Now! The gang looked at their one-eyed leader for direction. Austin said to the sergeant, Yeah, okay, for now then, and then reluctantly walked away as his posse followed him. Once the men were a good distance away, I said to the sergeant, Thanks for showing up. The sergeant replied, It was an anonymous tip, Linfeld. Not like you need the help anyway. My eyes were still locked on the four as they disappeared around the side of a nearby building. Just after the sergeant got back in his car and drove off, I made it a point to catch up with the girls. I always felt vulnerable when I wasn't with them. I didn't care about my own pain so much. It was them I always cared about. Regardless, it's been a week since the confrontation with the four went down. Because I was clearly outnumbered, I've decided to start carrying a combat knife on my belt wherever I go. I can handle myself against one person. But the faith others have in my abilities exceeds my own. Here I am in a foreign country, reminded on a daily basis to fear my country's enemies from the north, and yet the people I really fear live in the same damn building as me. I think they call those men Blue Falcons. They weren't the first I encountered in the military. We were enemies of foreign nations, and often ourselves.
Oh my god. I'm gonna have a fucking stroke.
That was chapter 21 of This Is Why I Hate You. The plot hasn't progressed at all.
this book is just a framework to talk about some dreamt up polyamorous relationship. That's it. It's a framework. If you took the plot of this book and stuck it in a college dorm, it would be the same. I don't understand it. And I honestly can't even believe somebody would write this and be like, this is it. This is the one. 'Cause it's not. But we can talk about that another time. This has been Doctorpiece Theater. And my name is Dr. Dennis Business. And as always, my friends,